there is a great deal of historical data available on Schlossberg, where he came from, the boat he came over on, he actually came over twice. All of that information is available, freely available on the internet. You can find it, just Google. But that's really historical data. It doesn't talk about how he really went about teaching. And he was, I think, the most important trumpet teacher in the United States in the 20th century because he changed the direction of how the trumpet was taught. In those days, the cornet culture dominated the way everything was taught. Eldon Benge, trumpet maker, former member of the Chicago Symphony Orchestra trumpet section, wrote a letter to the great Herbert L. Clark. And Clark wrote back to him, telling him that, advising him not to switch to the trumpet from the cornet because the trumpet had no future. You couldn't do anything. You could play some jazz on it, maybe, but you couldn't play a melody on the cornet. And the cornet was going to be the instrument of the future. Now, this was simply an American rehash of what that great humanitarian Jean-Baptiste Urban was pulling off in Paris, where he really tried to get the trumpet taken out of the mix. The trumpet has no future. Even though he was a student of a guy by the name of Delvernay, who was a marvelous, one of the great real trumpet teachers. Schlossberg believed, and I think it demonstrated what kind of a prophet he really was, that the trumpet was the future. So you have to look in the historical context. He's coming in, he's teaching the trumpet in 1915. He's teaching the trumpet in 1920. What do you have at that point? You've got the jazz revolution starting, just starting. You've got what was vaudeville then would eventually morph into Broadway show type things. That kind of playing and that kind of mentality morphed into films, film music, studio music, you know. And all of those, in all of those contexts, the trumpet, he thought, was better suited than the cornet. I mean, can you imagine in 1952, Maynard Ferguson playing lead trumpet in the Kenton 52 band on a cornet? I mean, that trombone section would have taken him to the cleaners. I mean, you wouldn't have heard anything. Schlossberg, believing the trumpet was the future, created a problem for him because we didn't have any trumpet-specific literature in the training. You've got Mary Franquin, you've got Daubernay, some of the older things, but you don't have any real trumpet literature. In all of the schools, the emphasis was on the cornet. If you got the Arban's book, as it was printed by Carl Fisher in the United States, it said, this is for the cornet, and then it would put them parenthetically, oh, the trumpet, yeah. And a lot of things were like that in this country because the cornet pedagogical mafia was controlling everything. You know, we had a concert band kind of mentality in this country. When I was a little one, in 1948, I picked up my first instrument. I had to play the cornet. And when you would go to music festivals or music camps as little ones, they were having really serious arguments. You can go back and look at the Instrumentalist magazine, which was basically a tool of the music educational establishment, a music education establishment. And they were having serious arguments. Is it the trumpet the future or is the cornet the future? And it became quite serious. I mean, these people, and they wouldn't let up on it. But this was even after 20 years after Schlossberg started teaching the trumpet. Of course, within time, Schlossberg's students sort of took over the business. His students were the ones that were successful and made it into the profession. The guys who were playing cornets in the Johnson's Wax Band in northern Pennsylvania, I mean, that they're playing a cornet soloist. It was a different mentality. Schlossberg was faced with the dilemma of, what do I use for teaching materials? And so he chose to use Arban and Saint-Jacome and all of the traditional cornet materials, but he had them play those things as a trumpet player would play it. Now, what does that mean to us today? It means that you have vertical alignment. What does a trumpet do? You know, 75% of the time, trumpets are playing with other people. So they line up the notes vertically, so you can play as an ensemble instrument. Schlossberg believed, he didn't believe there would ever be trumpet soloists. He always thought they were going to be just trumpets playing in ensembles. We didn't have trumpet soloists. I mean, today you've got Hokan, you've got Gabry, all the guys, all these people are playing trumpet, but they didn't have anything like that. Even when I was going to school and college, there were no trumpet soloists. There was no real trumpet soloist playing in a major venue until Maurice André really broke the ice and started playing with major orchestras. It just didn't happen. And you look at the Columbia Artist Management catalog of their artists in 1954, and they had a trumpet player by the name of Adolf Scherbaum. And it said he was the only trumpet soloist they had, and he was available to play the only one piece that was for trumpet. He played the Brandenburg. And it said he was the only musician who could play the Brandenburg on the planet. And they sold him as that. That was the trumpet. There were no brass quintets. There was none of that stuff. All these things have happened in the second half of the 20th century. So Schlossberg was teaching ensemble musicians. Okay. What does that mean? I asked Pierre Thibault once, the famous teacher at the Paris Conservatory, and he really was a real student of the trumpet. I mean, he would go to the ends of the earth to learn what he could from whomever he came in contact with to pass those things on to his students. And I asked him he kept talking about the cornet this, the cornet that, and I said, well, what is the difference? He said, well, it's not only a different sound, and it's not, you don't put the air through the instrument in a different way. He said it was also a style. And I hesitate to show what he played for me because I can't do it. He did it with grace and elan and just pulled it off, you know, as if it were just part of him. I do it, I sound like an American klutz. But take this, and I apologize in advance if I'm in the wrong key. I mean, he had a way of doing it. I can't even possibly. I mean, it's just not part of my culture, and I can't think that way, and I defer to him on that. Schlossberg came along and said, okay, you're going to play it as if you're playing it with 100 other people. You're going to go. Right down the line. So that people can line up with you. You know, the Vacchiano had that whole thing about playing two notes at a time because you play in the cracks, and all you need is three or four people playing in the cracks, the ensemble goes to hell. You have to really put it. And it's not as if you were singing it. If you're going ta-ta-ta-ta, it sounds perfectly normal, but ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. Da 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 da. Yeah, I'm beating that. That third one is coming in ahead of time. Da 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 da. But if you hold back, pa 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 pa, it lines up. It's a very sterile, very academic and mechanical way of doing things. But when you get into a strict ensemble situation, there's no other way out. It's the only way they're going to play together. You don't think that way if you're playing solos. That's their job to play with you. That you're in charge. But when you're playing in an ensemble situation, okay, is it making any sense? Okay. So Schlossberg taught all of these things as trumpet things to be played in an ensemble context. It was not artistic. It was not soloistic. It was strictly nuts and bolts. You do these things because in those days, the emphasis was, I have to find work, I'm going to work, and if I'm going to find work, I'm going to have to learn to play with these groups. And so you learn those ensemble things. There's been a lot of controversy about Schlossberg and his teaching, and that's what I want to get into. These other things are sort of peripheral. When Schlossberg died, just as in the case when anyone dies, everybody knew him. Everybody studied with him. I like to tell the story of working in the Hollywood studios on films. I met at least, and the joke is, and among the trumpet players, the joke was always that we've met at least 150 guys who played concertmaster with the Philadelphia Orchestra. You know, they were all the former concertmaster of the Philadelphia Orchestra, and most of them, you heard him play, you know damn well he didn't even make it into the Philadelphia Orchestra. Everyone knew Schlossberg, and when I was a little person, I liked to play the Schlossberg book, just as many of you have, and it worked for me. And I was really fascinated with it, but I couldn't get straight answers. I didn't, even as a little person, I didn't trust what I was being told. Just didn't say, because you could tell, you know, when some guy picks up the trumpet and garbage rolls out the bell, and then he tells you how Schlossberg liked to teach, maybe. So over the years, without really trying to address that issue, I ran into five of the persons who I consider to be the very best, or among the best, of Schlossberg students, okay? I'll list them in alphabetical order. The first one was Lou Davidson. Louis Davidson, former principal trumpet, Cleveland Orchestra, student of Schlossberg, ended up teaching at Oberlin and then later at the University of Indiana in Bloomington. I met him, our orchestra played a concert there, and I had the misfortune of playing The Quiet City of Aaron Copland there. And after the concert, I went to the reception, as you all have to go to the receptions, you know. I went to the reception, and Lou came up, and he had to point out to me the mistakes I had made in The Quiet City. He said, it's written ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. I said, Lou, no, it's not written ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. I said, I played it with Copland. I actually have played it with Aaron Copland. And he said, it came, the Quiet City, you all know The Quiet City, right? The Quiet City was incidental music to a play, a Thornton Wilder play about 37, 38. It was about a little boy practicing, a person practicing the trumpet in the second floor apartment in New York. And down on the street level, a boy was bouncing a ball. And of course, anyone we know, as we bounce balls, the balls come up not as far each time. And so it was da-da-da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da. That's what he was imitating. And I told him that's what Copland wrote and blah, blah, blah. When we got through that argument, then I asked him about Schlossberg. But the story that I just told about the ball bouncing was verified. A colleague of mine, Malcolm McNabb, the famous Hollywood studio player, film player, he played it with Copland a few years after I did, and Copland told him almost verbatim the same story. And we had a mutual friend by the name of Charles Brady who had done it, and Copland told him the very same story. So it is about the boy bouncing the little ball, and it does come up and it's da-da-da-da-da-da. But Lou was not happy. You know, he was not happy at being corrected on that, as there were students there and seeing him being corrected, but the thing is, the guy was wrong. You can't just make up, and you cannot create your own reality about these things. When Aaron Copland said, this is what I wrote, I mean, that's just as far as it goes. I asked him about the Schlossberg book, and he was not happy with it. He knew Schlossberg well, and basically, I'll speak about it as we go through this, but basically he thought the guy who put the Schlossberg book together should have never been allowed to do so. And he was very strong in his language. I'll leave it at that. The second person, I took a couple of lessons by a guy by the name of Harry Glantz. Harry Glantz was the principal trumpet in the New York Philharmonic in the 1930s, 1940s, went with Toscanini to the NBC Symphony Orchestra in the 50s. That's when William Vacchiano moved over to principal trumpet from assistant at that time. And Harry Glantz was not fond of Schlossberg's playing because he thought that Schlossberg played like a cornet player, which is odd because here is this man who has made his career of trying to divorce himself from the cornet world and going to become the trumpet player, and yet Harry Glantz is saying he sounded like a cornetist. Harry Glantz told me basically my playing sucked because I sounded like Schlossberg or Nathan Prager. And the criticism was I sounded like I had too much like a cornet sound. I made too much of a cornet sound. And here, but anyway, Glantz was sort of the, he would love it if I said this and if he heard it. He was sort of the Adolf Herzef of his time. He was the big, he was the ultimate orchestral first trumpet player in the United States in the 1930s and 40s. He was the premium player. He gave me a couple of Schlossberg exercises to play. I later passed them around to friends. The next person I learned about Schlossberg was from a guy by the name of Nathan Prager. Nathan Prager was the second trumpet in the New York Philharmonic. Many people thought he was always the finest trumpet player in the New York Philharmonic. But Nathan Prager was one of those people who avoided, he eschewed the idea of having being a first trumpet player. Well, one would wonder, why did he not want to be the star? Why did he not want to be the first trumpet player? Well, it has to do with the, again, once again, the context of employment in those days. The conductors were autocrats. You screw up something, you could be fired. They used to have this sign, 2 weeks. That means you got 2 weeks notice and you're out of here. And they were frightened because they could be fired. They had mortgages to pay. They were raising families. They didn't want to put themselves on the line. The musicians and their unions and their player committees really started addressing these issues in the mid-50s. And by the mid-70s, musicians had the protection where you could screw up once in a while and you're not going to lose your job. And you had procedures for appealing if you should be fired. Excuse me. That was the world of Nathan Prager, and that's why he wouldn't get on the hot seat. He just didn't want to have anything to do with it. I once went to one of Michael Tilson Thomas's soirees following a concert, Leonard Bernstein. Bernstein gave me my favorite comments. He said, "I love the sound you make on the trumpet." He said, "It reminds me of Nathan Prager." I said, "You know, you couldn't give me a greater compliment. I love the way Prager." He said, "Oh, you know about Prager?" I said, "Sure, everybody knows about Prager. Trumpet players all knew about Prager." And I thanked him for that. And he said, "You know, there were times when I wanted to write in the second trumpet parts of my works," which many of them, even before he became the music director of the New York Philharmonic, were played by the New York Philharmonic. And he said, "I always wanted to put some trumpet solos in there. In fact, in I think maybe some of the West Side Story dances or something, there are some second trumpet, important second trumpet parts." He said, "Because I wanted to hear Prager." He didn't like Vacchiano's playing very much. He thought Vacchiano played like he was playing a baritone horn. But he loved Prager's sound. But he said his orchestrators, the people who he was working with, said, "That's fine, except every orchestra doesn't have Nathan Prager sitting on the second trumpet chair. You could get yourself in big trouble writing too many difficult solos in the second trumpet parts." It was an interesting conversation to know that people are actually paying attention to what's going back there in the demilitarized zone where we worked, you know. Prager had a student who was a friend of mine, and we wanted him to teach us about Schlossberg. So there was a room down the street from Carnegie Hall, the backside of Carnegie Hall, where the New York City Ballet or Opera used to rehearse. There was a building there. And so this guy, this friend of mine, said, "I'll organize a clinic, a seminar in Schlossberg's work. And we'll get Nathan Prager to do it. It will cost you each $5. So we jumped at the chance, and I went down. We went in there, they had about as many chairs as you have in this room here, and only five guys showed up. It was really embarrassing to hear this great trumpet player walks in. Only five guys are interested in hearing what he has to say. But it was good for us because we learned a great deal. I mean, it was a very personal experience. And then we did a second one because we hoped if there were better publicity that more people would come. And they did, more people came. Two more people. So we had seven students. We learned a great deal about Schlossberg from him and how Schlossberg went about teaching. The fourth of my five was a man by the name of James George Stamp. James George Stamp was a country bumpkin. He grew up in the hills of Minnesota, played in bands and orchestras had pretty good keyboard skills. He became the principal trumpet with the Minneapolis Symphony. That's known today as the Minnesota Orchestra. He became the principal trumpet at a very young age. He was probably 20, 21 years old. The music director at the time was a man by the name of Eugene Ormandy. Eugene Ormandy went on to be a very famous music director for a long time of the Philadelphia Orchestra. At the time, Ormandy was just beginning. In those days, orchestras didn't have the kinds of schedules that they have these days. They worked about 30 weeks a year at best. So they always had the summer off. So Ormandy was very concerned that he had this inexperienced little boy playing first trumpet in his orchestra. So Ormandy took it upon himself to contact Max Schlossberg. We have the letters to see if Schlossberg would consider teaching James George Stamp, his first trumpet player, because he had a lot of important repertoire to play the following year, and he wanted Mr. Stamp to be able to play this stuff. And he sent a letter to that effect. And then I have here the correspondence. Anybody can look at it if they want. "My dear Stamp," he says, "my dear Stamp." And he talks about how he arranged and signed here by Eugene Ormandy, the back, famous conductor, how he wants Max Schlossberg to make sure that Mr. Stamp is qualified to play the next season as first trumpet and play the parts. And this is important because a lot of people don't realize that in spite of James Stamp's fame, he's really a Schlossbergian. Most of his principles come right from Schlossberg. The only changes he made was he did the emphasis on mouthpiece drills and things. Those were done largely due to the influence of one of my colleagues, Irving Bush, who was very close to him. And Bush started experimenting with mouthpieces and mouthpiece drills. And then Jim took it a step further. The fifth person was William Vacchiano. William Vacchiano was the longtime principal trumpet at the New York Philharmonic and the main professor at Juilliard for how many years? Four decades, maybe? For four decades. Trained enough trumpet players to fill a small town. Vacchiano came about studying with Schlossberg in a rather strange way. He had studied with a man by the name of George Magier, M-A-G-E-R, and the George, I think, had an S on it, George Magier. And George Magier was really the father of modern-day American orchestral playing. Not many people know about him because he lived at a time before videotapes, before publishing, before recordings. The only recording I know of his was a recording with the Boston Symphony of the poem, the Scriabin poem of ecstasy, which I think was done down in New Jersey in that dirigible hangar, right? The RCA used to use a dirigible hangar. The rumor was always it was the same place where the Hindenburg crashed, but I don't know that for sure. But it was a dirigible hangar and he recorded Ecstas. And if anyone can find it, it might be interesting. Magier was the first guy he really brought the C trumpet to us. He brought the C trumpet and he worked with Vincent Bach in developing the earlier C trumpets that Bach developed. And it's a very interesting teacher because without him, we wouldn't have had Roger Voisin, Adolf Herseth, William Vacchiano, all Magier students. And you didn't do better than that. He came to the United States and he taught what we later called Vacchiano's rules. And he thought they were a kind of special kind of solfège that was taught at the Paris Conservatory in the 1910s, 1920s. It wasn't the solfège that we take in music school these days. It wasn't, which is mainly pitch recognition. It's not about performing antecedent and consequent phrases. It's not about cadential extensions. It's not about parts of speech. It's not about échappé, cambiati. It's none of the how they affect the way phrases are done. It was a performer solfege, and a lot of the leading American woodwind players, the most famous was Marcel Tabuteau, was the oboe player with the Philadelphia Orchestra, taught at the Curtis Institute, and almost all of the great oboe players in the United States go back to Tabuteau. And Mauger brought that to the United States, and he taught in Boston, and these three famous guys came out, and of course they set the standard for orchestral playing in the United States after that. I was, in 1979, I worked with some of the students at Paris Conservatory with Thibaut. It was a very informal thing. I was there for something else, and Paris for something else, and went over, and we worked with him, and I asked him afterwards, why is it that none of these students has a clue about any of this? It came from this school. What's going on? And Pierre, it became then a sociology problem. He said that the brass players were never allowed in those courses because they were thought to have been of a lower social or musical class, and they weren't allowed in those courses, right? The old metal workers syndrome. I asked, well then, that destroys this whole myth about Mauger having brought all this stuff to the United States and using his influence. He said, no, Thomas, no. He said, Mauger was the exception because Mauger had a double major at the Paris Conservatory. He had diplomas in both viola and cornet. And in those days, I guess they called it what? A cornet, a band instrument and an orchestral instrument. If you played the trumpet, you could get by with being only a trumpet player. But if you're a cornet player, you're playing a band instrument, you have played the viola. I have copies of his diplomas, not only from the National Conservatory in Paris, but also a year that he spent in Belgium at a lesser school before he went there. We have documented all of this. Anyway, so I said, well then, Pierre, what happened? He said, well, he was a viola player, so he took all these elite courses. I mean, here's a trumpet player who can read and write at least one language, you know, isn't that odd? So he learned all of those things. So he was the exception. And he said, of course, America lost because you got Mauger, we kept Favot, you know, and you got America. I said, well, you know, if you've got a guy who developed Adolf Hirsch with William Vacchiano and Roger Voisin, we didn't lose anything, you know. What the hell you guys developed? No one had developed guys like that. Mauger, this teacher, had taught Vacchiano. He had taught him in high school. He used to take the bus from Portland, Maine, down to study with George Mauger. But he had no plans of being a professional trumpet player. He wanted to be an accountant. And he went to two different universities, one of which was St. John's University. And we don't know the truth. You know, when people talk about their academic credentials, you never really get the truth. He either failed the entrance exam, or he tested out badly, or his high school transcript wasn't good enough. For some reason, he was denied entrance into both of those schools. So we figured, well, you know, he's in New York, and this may be the last time he's ever in New York. So he's going to go down to Times Square. And he went to Times Square. In those days, he was 18 years old. His nickname was Willie. And he goes to Times Square, and he saw a guy by the name of Jones. And Jones, I don't know his first name, but Jones was a freelancer in the Boston area. And he said, Willie, what are you doing here? What are you doing here? And Vacchiano gave him the song and dance about St. John's University. And he said, as long as you're here, you must take a lesson with Max Schlossberg. It'll cost you $3. This was at the height of the Great Depression. $3 was a week's worth of food in those days. And Bill just didn't have it. He couldn't afford it. He said, I can't afford it. Jones says, I'll stake you. I'll pay for the lesson for you. You've got to play for Max Schlossberg. So he went up and played a lesson for Schlossberg, and Schlossberg was absolutely overwhelmed and knocked out with him. And he said, you must come to study with me at the Institute, and you will make telephone numbers. He didn't know what it meant at the time. What he meant was, you'll make telephone numbers, in other words, that many numbers in money. You must study with me at the Institute. was called the Damrosch Institute of Music and Art. A few years later, a man who made men's suits by the name of Juilliard endowed the school, and then it became called, it became the famous Juilliard School. Vacchiano went to that school, graduated after 4 years, and went immediately into the New York Philharmonic Orchestra as third and assistant first. And he had one of the great audition stories of the trumpet lore. In the morning, he had played an audition for third trumpet in the Met, Metropolitan Opera, and he got it. And he thought that was fine. You know, he was recently married, fine, he's gonna have a good time, it's a great job. And they said, no, you have to play for Toscanini, for the New York Philharmonic. All of this is documented on film. We've got this, so we're not making up stories here. It's all documented in his own words. So we went in, and they reduced it to two trumpet players, Louis Davidson, another Schlossberg student, and William Vacchiano. He walked in, and Toscanini said, you know the little solo from Lemaire? Ta-da, the famous solo. He said, can you play that? Vacchiano plays it. He said, fine, you go upstairs and listen to the next person, which I assume was Lou Davidson. Then they bring him down again a second time. They said, you know that little solo from Lemaire? Oh yeah. He's thinking, did I screw up something? You know, I did do something wrong? He said, yeah, I know it. Can you play the little solo from Lemaire? Vacchiano plays it again. He said, okay, go upstairs. Goes upstairs, they bring in Lou again to play. So they bring him down for the third time. And Toscanini comes in and he says, Lemaire. Three notes, Lemaire. And then he starts to get paranoid. What am I doing wrong? Why does this guy keep wanting to hear that? And so he played it again. And he said, okay, you're hired. You got the job. He got the job in the New York Philharmonic playing three notes. Three notes. Three times. That's nine notes, man. You believe it? When you get those audition lists in the mail to audition for the Dallas Symphony, and it's three pages long, and you think this guy played nine notes? Anyway, and so he got the New York Philharmonic job. And of course, the rest is history. Okay, this comes to the next point, and which is this is what it's really about here, is how did he teach? That's what most people don't understand about Schlossberg. Number one, Schlossberg started this idea of dealing with students' liabilities. He would categorize students as having assets and liabilities, the things that they could already do and the things they couldn't do, which means that he was teaching all individual students. He was not teaching a generic method. He took each student as an individual. This practice was followed by James Stamp, and it was also followed by William Vacchiano. They had a kind of musician's version, trumpet player's version, of the physician's Hippocratic oath. First, do no harm. If someone can do something already, they would not touch it. In my own case, I had a very good teacher when I was a little boy, and I was really good with multiple tonguing, or tonguing in general. I could tongue legato, staccato. It was a part of me. Maybe the same way one learns language. They got me when I was really young, and I never needed. Not one of those teachers, Stamp or Vacchiano, ever gave me a lesson on how to tongue. So as a consequence, I could never tell someone, this is how James Stamp taught tonguing, or this is how Vacchiano. They never said a word about that to me. What does this mean? The manifestations are that if you go to any so-called Stamp expert or a so-called Schlossberg expert, they can only relate to things as they know them, as they were taught. If there were things that they already knew, they had no clue of how to help you with it. Is this making any sense to you? They had no clue. So Schlossberg taught, as did Vacchiano and Stamp, they addressed people's liabilities. That's a really important concept. If you could already do something, they didn't mess with it. And that's why when you deal, for example, if you're going to study James Stamp, there are all kinds of stamp experts out in the world, but they can only relate to their own experiences with stamp. And if it involved things they could already do, they wouldn't have a clue. I started playing with James Stamp. I was his second trumpet player in Metropolitan Orchestras in 1959. I knew him as a trumpet player before I knew him as a teacher. And then I went with him in Europe. When he went to Europe, he was introduced to Europe, and then I went with him when he was introduced to Japan. And I had a unique position. I was a retranslator, because James Stamp spoke in American colloquialisms. And he was not very verbal. And as a result, I would have to translate it into global English, what he said, and then the translators could take it from there. And, you know, because our publisher at the time, I remember the thing, I've told many people this story, that our publisher said, what will happen if you say, go get me a pizza quick and step on it? You know what's going to happen when the Japanese translate that? You know, it's not going to work. So you have to really translate things or retranslate them in so they make sense. It has to make sense in a kind of global English kind of way. And Hokan was there as what you watched some of that. And the big problems were the students didn't know what he was saying a lot of times. They were just completely flummoxed. They didn't know what did he say? Didn't make any sense. So I know a little bit about the way Stamp taught things other than the things he taught me, as opposed to all of the stamp experts who all of a sudden became Jimmy's best friend the day after he died. You know, and the same thing. Okay. And the same thing with Vacchiano and all the rest. Okay. So Schlossberg addressed liabilities, what you can't do. He also personalized the teaching. Now, what we have is the Schlossberg Daily Drills and Technical Studies, the famous book. That's nothing. That hardly cracks the surface of what Schlossberg did. He also had an uncanny ability to write down little exercises. And near the end of his life, he would sit in a room at the end of a hallway. And it was like going to the gas chamber, you know, or the electric chair. You walk down this large hallway and you would walk into this room, and he was sitting behind a desk like the high school principal. And he would sit and the people would play for him. I learned this from a man by the name of John Barnett, who became a conductor. I think he was the conductor of the National Orchestral Association in New York. And you would walk down and then he would say, you're such and such, is such and such, do this 35 times, okay? Or 25 times or whatever it is and come back in 2 weeks. Almost like a doctor issuing prescriptions, okay? Those things were all kept in Schlossberg's studio. He kept a lot of those things. But a lot of them were not kept in Schlossberg's studio. A lot of them were not kept in Schlossberg's studios. There, Bob Malone, I think Hokan, Marcus Stockhausen have all seen Jimmy's notes. Jimmy Stamp had a little booklet of his individual things that Schlossberg wrote for him. And there are probably at least 100 or more of those little individual booklets probably sitting in closets around the United States in families that didn't know they were important. So that this represents the total output of Schlossberg, okay? What happened is that Schlossberg got very ill, and I don't know the details. I'm sure they've written somewhere. You can probably Google them. But he had some serious illness, and he died. Once it took over, he died in a relatively quick time. It was just probably a few months. And he was so broke, had no money, that he was actually teaching from his hospital bed. This was really a very sad story. Teaching from his hospital bed. And he left all his notes. He died. Well, enter a man by the name of Harry Freistadt. Harry Freistadt married Schlossberg's daughter. Schlossberg didn't like Freistadt. Most of the trumpet players who were close to Schlossberg didn't like Freistadt. Louis Davidson said he thought Freistadt was the worst person who could have put together that book, and almost thought maybe he should be taken out and hanged for it. He went in and found all the notes in Schlossberg's studio, all the notes, all the scribbled notes and things. And he's a smart guy, and he knows how to capitalize on that. So he took the slurs, and he put them over here. And he took the interval studies, and he put them over here. And he put the tonguing studies, and he put them over here. And it looks like a halfway decent, organized book. But it's nonsense. The problem with Harry Freistadt's inclusions into the book was that those were exercises that were written to address specific problems of specific students. And we're going to do some demonstrations now to show what I'm talking about. So he neutralized everything. This was the first of two basic problems with the Schlossberg book. For example, we have number 80 in the Schlossberg book. For those who have played the book, you know, it's... But you all know that, right? Schlossberg put in the book, mezzo forte, sempre staccato, number 80. Mezzo forte, sempre staccato. We assume, and then it says simile later, we assume you play the whole thing that way, right? James George Stamp's version of number 80 said fortissimo martellato. Not mezzo forte, sempre staccato. Vacchiano's copy of number 80 said pianissimo staccato. Now, what are we drawing from that? We're drawing that Vacchiano couldn't play pianissimo staccato, and Stamp couldn't play heavy, hammered, martellato fortissimo. So what does Freistadt do? He brings this book in and goes in the middle, takes the middle road, mezzo forte, staccato. Well, that's not going to help you. So we're going to test out this theory right now with our spontaneous trumpet soloists. You get the Schlossberg book, that is the what. You have to write on the front of that book how and why. How are you going to play those things, and why are you going to play them that way? It's really important. For example, one of the things he rebelled against was this idea with Arban and most of the cornet players, is we started always on the low notes, where we'd go... And then later on, you go... And then later on... This brings up an interesting thing that shows the influence of Schlossberg on Stamp, is that Schlossberg always had people think in the middle of the phrase. So you started an exercise like that in Schlossberg, you'd start in the middle C, the trumpet middle C, in the middle of the staff. And then you'd go down a little, and then you go up, and then you go down and go up. That way, high C is over here, low C is over here, and you're playing in a relaxed way. You're not starting down here, and you're going to make it, climb the mountain. Always think in the middle of a phrase. That came from Schlossberg. Stamp got a lot of credit for it, but it's really Schlossberg. Martellato fortissimo. That was very good, Mr. Hawkins. Now, can you try the Vacchiano version? Play it pianissimo, secco, staccato, secco. He missed some notes. He needs to work on, see, this is what Schlossberg would do with him. He'd say, hey, you had trouble, right? Now try it again. You see, that's the point. He needed to concentrate on that because that was the weak suit. He can play the big stuff. He had trouble. He's more like Vacchiano. Making sense? Yeah? Okay, you're excused, sir, and we're going to do another excerpt in a few minutes. Spontaneously, of course. Another thing, famous exercise, the second one, last of two, up that I'm going to show you, is something that was first introduced to me by Melvin Broyles, otherwise known as Melvin the Magnificent, the principal trumpet in the Metropolitan Opera. Really a phenomenal trumpet talent, could really play the trumpet. And he showed me an exercise that was meant, was designed by Schlossberg to help you with your soft attacks. We all have trouble with soft attacks. That's the bane of trumpet playing. So he gave me this exercise, and it goes like this. And I thought, you know, this cat's putting on a little kid, you know, he's just having fun making jokes with me, ha, ha, ha. I taught this guy, ha, ha, ha. It's like the story that Clark Terry told about how to play high notes. The teacher in East St. Louis who taught Miles Davis and Clark Terry and a number of other, and he used to tell the kids that they should sit in front of a mirror, sit down, cross their legs, and then squeeze the left ear, and they could. That's how they played the high notes. And he said, this gentleman, he called him a gentleman. He said, this old gentleman had all the kids in East St. Louis, Missouri, trying to fix their heat, you know, sitting down, crossing their leg. That, you know, so I thought it was one of those things. I knew that Clark Terry story, and I thought, you know, Mel is just fooling with my head. And then Vacchiano, he showed me the same damned exercise, and I thought these guys are in conspiracy. You know, it's probably something they do when they go out for drinks and pasta, and they talk about how many guys they got sucked into this playing this stupid exercise, you know. But then I heard, I went backstage in Carnegie Hall, the Chicago Symphony had come to town. I went backstage. I had known one of the members of the orchestra, and I started to believe. And it was true. It was to help your soft. And most people, I could never play it. There was a time in my life when I was in what I would call my prime, if there were such a thing. And I remember I could really do that. I could play that damn thing. I can't play it now. It's an old codger. I can't play it now. So would you like to come up? As loud and as ugly and as dry as you could possibly play this thing, about like this. One, two, three, one, okay? I played in Sir George Schulte's all-star band for the 50th anniversary of the United Nations in Geneva. It was basically a Chicago brass section with the Concertgebouw horns led by Dale Clevenger from Chicago. And Sir George kept looking at me and he said, you know, Tommy, I love you, he said, but you've been in Los Angeles so long, you no longer have a fortissimo. I can't hear you. Well, of course, his idea of hearing a trumpet is having Hirsut put his bell in his face, you know. Now, you don't have a fortissimo, my dear.
Okay.
I mean, okay? Too much sound. Cut it shorter. You want just the very beginning of the sound. This is going to help your soft attacks, you see. You see, that's hard. It's a nonsense. You can play this. You'll be surprised at how quick your response is after about a week or so. Soft attacks. Schlossberg's whole thing was the note just speaks. It's the start of the note. Very good, low C, huh? Continue the series. Dum, ba 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 fa. Yeah, but no, okay?
Keep going?
Yeah. He's not doing it as just in a distorted way as Schlossberg had it done. When Melvin the Magnificent played that thing at me, my head hurt. You know, it was just good. And I really thought he was putting me on. I should have taken it seriously. Okay. Very good. Thank you. Okay. What I've tried to do here with these silly excerpts, the just little silly excerpts, is demonstrate that the Schlossberg book is, in fact, legitimate Schlossberg. Number two, it's incomplete because the only Schlossberg that was published were the exercises Harry Freistadt found in the studio of Max Schlossberg following Schlossberg's death. So there are many of them out there that are missing. Other than that, I think one should play from the Schlossberg book. I have played from that book my entire life as a trumpet player. But I have written on my old Schlossberg book, since we know what the book is, it's how these things are supposed to be played and why they're supposed to be played that way. Find out what you can't do. If you play number 80, try to see if you can play it as it was prescribed to Jimmy Stamp. Try to see if you can play it as it was prescribed for William Vacchiano. Go in there and really say, try every kind of variation on those exercises. If you can already do something, follow the Schlossberg principle. Don't waste your time. You can already do it. It's part of your life. You don't need to work on it. The only thing you can do by working on it is probably hurt yourself. Or hurt you, what you can do. Try to look at the book. If you look at it as a book of exercises to be interpreted by you, the book can really work. It can be magnificent. And so that's really all I have to say about Schlossberg. I wanted to get these things on tape because not many people have done the research and have really tried to get to the bottom of where these things came from, the origins. The book is incomplete, as I've said. If you ever meet a Schlossberg student or the grandson of a granddaughter of a Schlossberg student, see if they have any of those old notes in their basements. We were lucky with Jimmy Stamp, he saved them. So we saw Jimmy Stamp's. So anyway, play the Schlossberg book. I published my own version, it's called After Schlossberg. What I included in that book were some of the exercises that were given to me by various Schlossberg students, and they were not in the original book. It is not meant in any way to be a substitute for the real thing. It's just, here are some variations on what Schlossberg did. The only thing my book really contributes is the fact that I made every exercise start in the middle and go up and down and up and down and up and down rather than starting in the bottom. If Harry Freistadt had used his head, he would have organized the book in a different way instead of always starting at the bottom. start in the middle and go both ways. So anyway, get the Schlossberg book, play the Schlossberg book, but on the front cover put how and why. And I finished. I'm out of here. Thank you.